Well, I want to let you know, I thank God for the snow, for the cold weather, for winter. I thank God. And y'all should too. If I got to be miserable in summertime, y'all should be miserable in the winter. All right, isn't that good? I tell you, I feel good today. Snow helps, but I just felt good anyway. God's good. I'm telling you. Let's stand. I don't have to tell you God good. He know, you know it. Okay. Anybody, if you've got a request, I'm just going to pray and you accept what God gives you. Father God, we thank you for this opportunity to be here today. We thank you, Lord, for your word. We thank you for the privilege of being able to come and to study it. We thank you, Lord. I thank you, Lord, for the weather. I thank you for the snow. I pray, God, that you would give these people patience and understanding. I ask, Lord, now that you would bless each and every one. I pray, God, for the ones who has a physical need. I pray that your healing hand would come down upon it. And, Lord, that you would raise them up and give them the strength. For others who are just has trials and tribulations, Lord, I pray that the Holy Spirit would lead and guide them. I ask, Lord, that you would use the word as they study it, as they read it, to give them encouragement and enlightenment. I thank you, Lord, for each one that's here, and Lord, I pray that we will be able to understand more of your word. I ask, Lord, that you would just bless and keep, and Lord, I thank you for the privilege of being able to stand here before you. Help me through this lesson, Lord, let the Holy Spirit have his way, and I ask you for these things in your name, and everyone said, amen. Amen. All right, I have been trying to teach, on things that's really familiar. Because I think that we are getting to the place that if we know it, we know it. What I'm saying is, we just take it for granted. We read it, we understand it, that's it. And for some reason, the Lord has really been putting this on us that we need to come back to the beginning. There was a man, an older man, who was preaching. And he had a church, and he was getting up, and he said, "Today, I'm going to preach on John 3:16. Everybody said, "Oh, good. We love John 3:16. So he preached on John 3:16. Next Sunday of the month, he came back and he said, they said, "What are you going to preach on today, preacher? And he said, John 3:16. Said, John 3:16? Said, "Yep." All right. So church next week come, they said, "Pastor, what are you going to preach on?" And he said, John 3:16. Said, John 3:16? You know, why are you preaching on John 3:16? He said, "I'm going to preach it until you guys understand it." And I think that's what we do. We know so much about it. We understand it so clear that we just don't get it. And I'm not saying that you don't get it because you're... Well, that's not what I'm saying. I'm saying we get in a rut. And we read the Bible... And we understand it, so we don't study it. We read it, and we read it, and we read it. But we don't take it to heart. I believe, yeah, we believe, that we need to know. We need to get it deep in our heart. We need to know about it. And we should not get tired of certain scriptures. But I'm sure that there are scriptures in here that you've heard so many times. I used to write down the date in my Bible. This is going to sound terrible. Of how many times a preacher preached on that? On one section, one line. "For God so loved the world." Okay. Then we have another familiar one. What's a familiar one to you? Quickly. See, we don't know. What? See? Yeah. Judy likes that one in Proverbs. Which one do you like, Judy? You don't know. Exactly. You say, well, we know these over and over and over. And I think sometimes we just take them nonchalantly. It's just the way it is. We know it, we read it, we believe it, and that's it. So when the Lord began to deal with me about the Ten Commandments, I said, whoa. So I thought, well, I would try it. Well, it didn't come. Then I went to something else. And I thought God had forgotten about it. I said, okay. So I began to pray what to do for today. Last Sunday, you know, I didn't come in, and we didn't have Sunday school. And I said, okay, Lord, what is it do you want? And the Ten Commandments popped up. So this is what we're going to try. We are going to try to understand the Ten Commandments. We are going to try them. How many knows them? Yeah, exactly. We all know them, but we don't know in order. I'm as guilty as the next. The one I know, the two that we know, thou shalt not kill, and thou shalt not lie. And some knows it says, thou shalt not covet thy neighbor's things, but some people don't understand that. You say, why? Because we see so many wives are going and so many men going. They don't understand. God gave the Israelites this. He first gave it to Moses on Mount Sinai. And y'all know the story. Y'all know the story about that? Sure you do. Moses stayed up a little too long, and when they came back, they'd already committed the sin. And Moses broke those Ten Commandments. God got so angry. God got so angry, the Bible said, that he wanted to get rid of all of them. But Moses said, Lord, you can't do that. You talk to God like that? Sometimes I do. He said, you can't do that. And then the Bible says that God repented. So then he called him up again, and he said, you know, take this down there for the people. He forgave him, he gave him a chance. You see, one thing with God, he always gives us a second chance. He gives us a third chance. He gives us. But the commandments was a foundation of how a person should live. If we all lived like the commandments, we'd all be good. But we don't live under the law. We live under grace. And when we live under grace, here I go again. I don't know what you say, but sometimes, I know I said this to one person. He said, I'm a Baptist. And I said, well, if God forgives you, so will I. You see what I'm saying? We just take it so lightly. We just take it so lightly. I'm talking about me. Because I enjoy fun. I enjoy it. I enjoy. I was just telling her that my tongue, the scripture that I'm most afraid of is the one that says you will be judged by every idle word. You know what every idle word is? What does God think is every idle word? Every word that you say that does not pertain to him. So he gave him these Ten Commandments, and we are going to try, and I'm going to try to bring some of this stuff out. Turn with me to Deuteronomy chapter 5. Now the first was given in Exodus chapter 20. All right, we can have Deuteronomy chapter 5 somewhere. Here we go. And it says in verse 1, and Moses called all Israel, and he was telling us, the statutes and judgments which I speak in you, in your ears, this day, that ye may learn them and keep them and do them. God just didn't write this thing down. He didn't change any when he wrote the first Ten Commandments, and that got broken. He didn't change any rules. He wrote the same things over. Because there's something that we need to do. This is a foundation how we should live. And so Moses is saying, listen, this, I speak to you this day. The Lord our God made covenant with us. Verse 3 is what I want to get to. The Lord made not this covenant with our fathers, but with us, even us who are all of us here alive this day. You're saying, well, he's just talking to the Israelites. No, because the Bible says that in Malachi, he says, I am God and I change not. So if he required this of the Israelites, I got news for you. He requires this of us. Because Moses said, but with us, even us. Everything that is in this Bible was way back there is just as good today as it was back then. It's just as good. Why? Because it is for us who is alive today. These words, these commandments. These commandments is good. He said, the Lord talked to you face to face. He talks to us face to face, does he not? He gets down, you get down on your knees, and the Holy Spirit comes and talks to you and tells you what you should be doing and what you can't, should not be doing. And sometimes we listen, and sometimes we don't. In Hebrews, if this is true about God, Hebrews 13:8 says, Jesus Christ, the same yesterday, today, and forever. After John 3:6, I learned this scripture because that was our model in Foursquare. Jesus Christ, the same yesterday, today, and forever. Let me tell you, and God and Jesus are one. So, God or Jesus requires the same respect as the Lord does. Now we're going to verse 6. You got this on your Bible. He says, I am the God which brought you out of the land of Egypt from the house of bondage. He said, I am the Lord God. When somebody gives you a commandment, it's somebody who is in high authority. Do you agree that God is someone with authority? Yes. It's someone who has the power to carry things out. Do you agree that God does do that? Sure he does. And he said, I am the Lord thy God. He still was then. He's still today. Jesus is the same yesterday, today, and forever. He will always be the same. Now he starts in and he says, but thou shalt not have no other gods before me. I am the Lord God. I brought you out. I delivered you. I put you safe. What does Jesus do? He delivers us out of our sins. He keeps us safe. He meets our needs, just what God did with the Israelites. And he said, I'm going to tell you what I did. We all know what Jesus did. We all know what God did. We all know what he's doing. And we all know what he can do. But yet he had to remind them, he said, I am thy Lord. I am your Lord God. And don't have anybody, no other gods. Because back then, they had other gods. Back then, they served other things. If you were to read Revelation, and I should have looked this up, but I didn't, but it's in my mind. As I studied Revelation, I thought it was about in the 18th or 19th last. In one of the verses, the very last verse in a chapter, it says this. The Lord said, you, talking to the people who was left in the tribulation, said, you have seen all that I have done, But you have not changed. You still worship idols. You still live a deceitful life. And this is all paraphrased. But he said, you have not changed. And today, we do the same thing. We see what God does. He said, I brought you out of Egypt. I brought you out of your bondage. Jesus says, I will bring you out. If you come unto me, come unto me. If you will confess your sins, I am faithful and true to forgive you of all your... He is faithful and he's able to forgive us. That's what he did. He died on the cross for us. When God said, I brought you out of Egypt, Jesus could say, I died on the cross for you. Some people don't even accept that. Some people don't accept Christ as Lord. Some people don't accept him as the Savior. But in Romans 5:8 it says, but God commanded his love towards us, in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. What? God loved you enough to send his son to die for you. And always somebody says, how many would die for somebody else? How many would give your kids to die for somebody else? Nobody's going to raise their hand for that. Last week in Indianapolis, an 18-year-old girl ran off the road into Eagles Creek or Eagles Lake or whatever it is. She got on her phone and she said, my car is in the water. It's going down. I'm going to drown. And this man, the cop, this policeman, was nearby. And he got out of his car. He dropped off his gun. He jumped in that water. And he got that girl out. You say, okay. But he went back into the water to see if anybody else was in that car. My first thought was, why didn't you just ask her? I mean, that'd make more sense to me. I got you out. Is there anybody else in there? But the point was, he did not question. He just did it. Now, there is a Chinese proverb. I think it's Chinese. It's some kind of knees. Anyway, that says, if you save a life, you are responsible for that life. God said, I delivered you from Egypt. The Bible says in Romans, so Paul wrote, by God's command, that God commanded his love towards us. Us who does not deserve it. Israelites probably didn't deserve it, but he sent his love, he delivered them. He sent Christ to deliver us because he loved us. How many accepted Christ as your personal Savior? Yeah. He died for you. So what does that mean? It means that he is the one who's going to take care of you. And he does. And so he says, listen, you cannot have any other God because there is no other God can do what my God can do. No other God can do what I can do. I am God. I brought you out. I fed you. I led you. I protected you. I am your God. And if you think I want you to go and bow down or serve other gods, you're mistaken. Because I am responsible for you. I love you. I saved you. And I brought you out. So don't you dare go to another god. But not here. They had sun gods, moon gods, all kinds of gods. You know, after he said not to do that. Can't you see why God got mad when they broke the first commandments? The tablets? How much he loved them, and they didn't even have enough patience to say. How many has enough patience to wait for God to bring you through of something? It's hard. It is hard. But he says, I am your God, and don't have anybody else in front of you. Don't you worship anybody else. I brought you out, and I will keep you, because that's what he does. So it's good, it's important that we don't let other people, other things, get in our way of serving our God. But we do. That's what I'm saying. We take this so lightly because we don't. I heard a man Wednesday night, and he. How many knows where it says in the Bible where you bury your own cross? Do you remember that's what it says? You can bury your own cross? What is your own cross? Have you ever thought that out? You see what I'm saying? We know it, but have we thought it out? And he says this. He said, God gave me this, and he has preached it several times, and he says, it always comes out different and always have good results because God is in it. But he said, I've found out this. Our cross that we have to bear is turning our will over to him. If he could have our will, we would serve him like he wants us to serve him. But he won't take our will from us. So we have to give him our will. Our will has to be his will. His will has to be our will. And I listened to that and I thought, wow, I never thought of that. I never thought of it. You see, when we read the Ten Commandments, we don't think any about this. Well, thou shalt not have other gods before me. Well, I don't do that. Well, think. You may not call them gods. You may call them excuses. You see, we got different names. Just how names have, words have came today that doesn't mean the same as yesterday. When I was in school, long time ago, when the gay people started coming out, do you know what gay meant? That ain't what that meant. It meant got AIDS yet? Got AIDS yet? Think about it. Hey, used to be for horses and animals, but down south it means hello. You see, so when he says, thou shalt not have gods, other gods before me, you don't serve other gods, but we use so much other excuses that we don't have to come in, that we don't have to do what he says to do. We put our will before what he wants. And he wants us to serve him. He doesn't want us to have other gods before him. He doesn't want that. He wants us to serve him. He is a jealous God. He's a jealous God. How many of you husbands are jealous of your wife? And I don't mean that you're jealous that she's got more. I mean you get jealous when somebody looks at her. Why did you do that? Jealousy is good, but it can be bad. And the word says that he's a jealous God. Why? Because he wants all of our affection for him. That's why you can't have other gods. You can't serve two masters. You can't have one foot in the world and one foot for God. It don't work. If you straddle the fence, you're not good to anybody. If you don't make up your mind what you're going to be or how you're going to serve God, you cannot be anything. And if you're not moving forward, if you're just standing still, you're falling back. He has given us these commandments so that we can serve Him the way He wants us to serve Him. He wants us to. He doesn't want us to have other gods before Him. Salvation is for, let me take this so I can read it. Salvation is found through Him alone, through Christ. You see, we're talking about God. God gave the commandments, but what He said in the Old Testament is also true in the New Testament. What He said in the Old Testament is also for us today. And the Scripture says salvation is to be found through Him alone. In all the world there is no one else whom God has given who can save us. There is no one else. No one else but Jesus. He gave us Jesus. Jesus and God are one. Jesus said, "My Father and I are one." You can't separate it. He said, "I can't do anything without my Father." When you accept Jesus, you accept God. When you serve Jesus, you serve God. That's the only one that He wants you to have. He doesn't want us to have the TV. He doesn't want us to have the internet. He doesn't want us to have that. He wants us to have Him. He wants us to find the answers in Him. I don't have internet, so I don't know what you can find on the internet. See, I'm trying to be proud because I don't have internet. Truth is, I wouldn't know how to use it if I did have it. So anyway, he's a jealous God. And jealous, if a person is jealous, it means he's very watchful and careful in guarding and keeping. Doesn't that sound like God? Doesn't that sound like God? That's why He's a jealous God. Because He doesn't want to lose either one of you. He doesn't want to lose anyone. When Jesus was praying, He said, "Father, I have kept all that You have given to Me except one." He doesn't want us. That's why He's given these to us, so that we will know what we are supposed to do. He gave us the Ten Commandments so that we will know what to do. He has given us the Bible so that we would know what we have to do. He wants us to make it to heaven, people, but we have to do what we're supposed to do. You have to follow the Lord. You have to follow the Word. You have to be in fellowship. And let me tell you, if you are not doing these, and you're saying, "Well, that's back." If you are not doing these, you are not in fellowship with God. But we don't consider that. We don't consider that the Ten Commandments is other than what God gave to Moses on the mountain. Let me ask you, and you think of it. When was the last time when you read the Ten Commandments? Last month? Well, I'm going to be honest with you. I hadn't read them for a long time. I mean, I'm just being honest with you. Did you know Ten Commandments? Yes, I knew Ten Commandments. Did you read them? I've read them, sure. How often did you read it? Well, not much. You know, they're in the Old Testament. I don't do. Let me tell you, Old Testament is history, what God has done and how He sent Jesus and what Jesus is doing. Everything that's in this Bible is important. We need to know that. We need to know what He can do. Verse 8, it says, "Thou shalt not make any graven images or likeness of anything that is in heaven above, or that is in the earth beneath, or that is in the water beneath the earth. Thou shalt not bow down thyself unto them, nor serve them, for I, the Lord thy God, am a jealous God, visiting the iniquities of the fathers upon the children and upon the third and fourth generation of them that hate me, and showing mercy to them, to thousands of them that love me and keep my commandments. Let me tell you, the reason he said it comes down is because we don't learn what God said or what people did. We don't learn. I had a teacher in Bible college, and she'd say, the reason that Judah was bad was because they saw what Israelites went through but did not take heed. They knew it wasn't right, but they did it anyway. It's like your mom. If somebody jumped off the bridge, would you go do it? Well, no. But if somebody lies when God says not to, and you tell, and you know the truth, do you say, yes, he did it? No, you keep your mouth shut. It's like when somebody kills somebody, and if you're with them, you don't have to pull the trigger. But if you are with them, you get punished the same. Because you could have stopped it. And how many of you saw people sin and not do anything about it? You're not looking at me. Well, okay, I'm a good example. Because I probably have done that. I know it's not right. One lady said, I don't vote because what's happening does not affect me. I said, how does it not affect you, lady? Do you drive a car? Do you buy groceries? Do you have to heat your house? How can you say it does not affect you? Because she sees it, but she doesn't care. And she's not going to speak up. And so here he says, thou shalt not bow down. Thou shalt not make any image. Well, let me tell you, there are churches who has images setting up there on the altar. And they go. And when they come in, they bow down. Is that not right? It's right. They said, we don't uphold Mary. But Mary was a good girl. She was a good woman. But they go through Mary to get to Jesus, to get to God. I know, 5 minutes. I was talking to a minister, a priest one day, and I was asking him about Catholicism. And you know they have the prayer beads. And I don't really know about prayer beads, but there's so many Our Fathers and so many Hail Marys. So I was talking to this minister, or this pastor, and I said, how do you do this? And they said, well, how do you know how many times you're supposed to pray? And they said, well, it's according to how bad the sin is. And the worse sin is, the more you have to say Hail Marys and Our Father. If you tell a lie, you might just have to do it once. But if you go shoot somebody, you might be doing the rest of your life. And I said, oh, really? He said, yes. I said, why don't you tell him, just get on the knees and ask the Lord to forgive him? He said, you got a good point there. You see, we got our graven images that we bow down to. And God said, I don't want that. I'm a jealous God. I don't want you to bow down to those. He doesn't mean as far as paintings, like that painting over there. But he would mean that painting if we thought that was something great and we gave it glory and worshiped it. That would be not what he wanted. He doesn't want, many of us have a cross, that you wear a cross. There's nothing wrong with that until you put your trust in that cross instead of the cross that Christ died on. You see the difference? Some people don't see the difference. But he said, listen, I don't want you bound down to other people. I'm God. I am God. But we have a habit to worship the things that he created instead of the creator. We have a habit of doing that. How many of you men say, oh, I love my car? Women, I love my house. I love my TV. I love this. I love that. I got to stay home. This is for you. I got to stay home to watch football. I can't miss my stories that come on. I can't miss that. Why not? They have become more important to you than God. And he said, I'm jealous. I'm jealous of it. Anything that takes its places of God. There is only one that represents, that is a representative of God. There is only one representative of God in physical form, and that's Jesus, the Word. Hebrews 1:3 says, he reflects the brightness of God, his glory, and is the exact likeness of God's own being. That's Jesus. That's who we serve. That's who we're supposed to bow down to. That's the person that we should love. Not these other things. Not these other things that takes place of God. Not these. Only Christ. You see, the Ten Commandments that was given back there is still good for today, because it's represented in the New Testament. It's history. It's what people did. We're supposed to learn from that. And Jesus sometimes has spiritualized the Ten Commandments, and we're going to get into that. Let me tell you, there's more to the Ten Commandments than not to kill, not to steal, not to lie. But we don't get into them. Those commandments, if we would put them to work today, we would be somebody that God would call a friend. He would fellowship with us. When we break these commandments, we break our fellowship with God. You say, well, it's just the Ten Commandments. No, it's more than that. It's a foundation of living right. Christ is the foundation of our salvation, of our Christianity. And you got to be here next week, because when we talk about using his name in vain, I was just shocked. But that will come up next. He is the only God. He doesn't want you to bow down to God and any other gods. And he does not want you to have graven images. And you say, I don't. Well, when you're asked to do something in church and you find the reason why you don't want to, you better think about it. Anything that places God or gets before God can be trouble. I know. God just didn't write this because he didn't have nothing else to do. He didn't just say, okay, I think I'll take today and I'll just write the Ten Commandments so that people, not only Moses, but the other people that's falling, can just read them and throw them aside. He didn't do that, people. If it's in the Bible, it's important to take notice of. And these Ten Commandments is important to know. The ones that's coming up, y'all be here. Because how many of us has ever taken God's name in vain? Listen, you have, and you didn't even know it. When I studied this, I thought, I didn't know that. When we talk about taking God's name in vain, we think about what? Profanity. And that's it. But people, I'm telling you, that is not it. There is so much more to taking God's name in vain. I just could not believe it. Be here next week. We're going to start with Well, 11. Taking his name in vain. This will open your eyes, people. Open your eyes. Father God, I know I didn't do a good job, and I pray, God, that you would let the Holy Spirit take it and let them begin to think about it. I pray, God, that you would just bless each and every one. Lord, I'm praying that we would take these things that we know so close, that we know so well, and begin to ponder on them. Lord, that we would read them and sit down and meditate on them and digest them and let it become a part of our life. Father, I just pray that you would just minister to all of us throughout this next week, Lord, that we would ponder upon your words that we read so that we can get stronger and closer to you. I ask that you would be with us with our next service, Lord. Bless the speaker, bless the singers, and all that has to depart. Lord, let the Holy Spirit come and have his way, for I ask these things in your name. And everyone said, amen.
Good morning.
How's everybody this morning?
Good.
I kind of want to say Merry Christmas with the way it looks like out there. Like, Happy Thanksgiving, right? I told the youth this morning, I was like, this is way too early. Winter starts December 21st. Why is there snow out there? Anyway, just a few announcements. Our Christmas dinner, please sign up by November 22nd. It's out there on the information desk. We need to sign up by November 22nd so that way we can give the outpost the count of number of people. And there's also a Menger Treat sign up out there. Men, if you want to go to that, all the information's out there. You can sign up for that as well. Tuesday night at 6:30 is our men's meeting. And then the ladies have a Bible study hosted by Darla on Thursday. It'll be here at the church at 7. So, ladies, you're welcome to come to that. And then this morning, we also have our plaques that we want to give out to our veterans. So if you're a veteran, I know we had you come up last week, but if you would just stand for us, I believe Roy's going to take them out to you so that way we know who to give these to. Just the two? Okay. Three? And then we got more, so if they're not here this morning, that's fine. We can give them to them later on. This is just a token of our appreciation. So would you give them a hand of applause? Thank you for their service. We thank you again. And if you guys would go ahead and stand with me, I'll go ahead and pray, and we can get into the worship this morning. Father, we thank you for this opportunity, Lord, that we can come and just be in your presence this morning. God, we just ask, Lord, that you would come and have your way. Holy Spirit, let your will be done here this morning. God, we just want to offer up our praise to you, Lord. We give you all the praise and glory, and we just thank you for this in your name. Amen.
Morning, church. We thank God for the teaching lesson that we heard this morning. And hopefully you came expecting, and we look forward to the word that he has for us this morning. We're in the Father's house, amen. Amen. Let's worship as we sing this first song, The Father's House.
Shame at the door, 'cause it ain't welcome anymore.
Are quaking, strongholds now are shaking, love is breaking through when the Father's in the room. Oh, love is breaking through when the Father's in the room. Lay your burdens down, here in the Father's house, check your shame at the door, can't the name welcome anymore. Ooh, you're in the Father's house, check your shame at the door, cause it ain't welcome anymore. Ooh, you're in the Father's house.
Hallelujah. Amen. Are you thankful for that this morning, church? I want Jason to sing that bridge again. Listen to that. Prodigals come home. The helpless find hope. Love is on the move when the Father's in the room. He's in this place today. Thank you, Lord.
Prodigals come home.
Hallelujah.
The helpless find hope. Love is on the move when the Father's in the room.
Yes, hallelujah. Thank you, Lord.
The dead come to life. Love is on the move when the Father's in the
miracles
room.
Take place.
Oh, miracles take place. The cynical find faith. Love is breaking through when the Father's in the room. Those Jericho walls are quaking. Strongholds now are shaking. Love is breaking through when the Father's in the room. Oh, love is breaking through when the Father's in the room. Ooh, lay your burdens down. Ooh, here in the Father's house, check your shame at the door. Welcome anymore. Ooh, you're in the Father's
house again.
Ooh, just lay your burden down. Ooh, we're in the Father's house. Check your shame at the door, cause it ain't welcome anymore. Your shame at the door, cause it ain't welcome anymore. Ooh, you're in the Father's house.
Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Oh, you're worthy. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you.
Amen. Amen. You're in the Father's house.
Amen.
Sister Poole talked a little bit about this morning. Come unto me is the title of this next hymn. You're in the Father's house, but don't stop there. Come to Jesus. Amen. He wants you. He wants his church. He wants us to worship him in spirit and in truth. Let's sing this old hymn, Come Unto Me.
heavy laden, come to me and rest. Come no longer tarry, I your load will bear. Bring me every burden, bring me every care. Come unto me. Disappointed, wandering here and there, dragging chains of doubt and loaded down with care. Few unholy feelings struggle in your breast. Bring your case to Jesus, He will give you rest. Stumbling on the mountains, dark with sin and shame, stumbling toward the pit of hell's consuming flame. By the powers of sin, deluded and oppressed, hear the tender shepherd, come to me and rest. Temptation often conquered him, has a sense of weakness brought distress within. Christ will sanctify you if you'll claim His best. In the Holy Spirit, He will give you rest. Come unto me.
Take my yoke upon you.
Heal me and be blessed.
Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Oh, we worship you, God.
Amen. Thank you for obeying the Lord this morning. Amen. Before Brother Cody comes for prayer requests, let's sing this song, church. The title is Open the Eyes of My Heart. Some of us just need our eyes open, period. We walk around like we're blind men. My, my, my. It's Jesus. Let's worship, church. Open the eyes of my heart.
Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see you,
Lord.
I want to see you.
Sing that again. Open the eyes.
Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart, I want to see you,
Lord,
I want to see you,
see you high and lifted up,
see you high and lifted up, shining in the light of your glory. Pour out your power and love as we sing holy, holy, holy.
Open the eyes.
Open the eyes of my heart, Lord.
Open the eyes of my heart.
I want to see you,
Lord. Sing that again. Open the eyes, Lord.
Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see you,
Lord.
I want to see you.
To see you high and lifted up.
To see you high and lifted up. Shining in the light of your glory. Pour out your power and love as we sing holy, holy, holy.
We sing holy, holy, holy.
My heart.
Would you give the Lord a hand clap of praise? God, you're so good. We bless your name this morning.
Hallelujah.
As we prepare to bring our prayer requests to the Lord, I want to read Proverbs 18, verse 10. It says, "The name of the Lord is a fortified tower. The righteous run to it and are safe." Is there a burden that you have in your heart today? Is there a need that you have in your heart, in your life today? Is there a lost family member that you have in your life today? The Lord is a fortified tower. That means He is strong. He's not going to crumble and fall away. You can run to Him. And you can be safe in His tower. You can be safe in His arms. If you have a need today, would you let us know by lifting your hands? Needs all around the room. I want you to know the Lord sees your need. You can run to Him and you can trust in Him. He can be that fortified tower for you this morning. Let's pray. Father, we thank you, God, that you are that fortified tower, that we can run to you and that we can be safe in your arms. God, you see every need that was represented here today, Lord. God, I pray, God, that Holy Spirit, you would go to be with each one of us. God, come and just meet our needs this morning, Lord. Lord, we thank you that you hear our prayers. We thank you that you are doing things that only you can do, Lord. We just pray for a miracle to happen this morning in each of our lives with each request that was represented here today. Jesus, we love you. Lord, we just run to you this morning. We give you all the praise and glory in your precious name. Amen. Let's praise the Lord.
Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art! How great! Shout of acclamation and take me home. What joy shall
Great he is. He is a magnificent God. Magnificent God. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Yes, Jesus is so good. Oh, yes, God. God is so good. Oh, yes, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord.
Oh, how magnificent you are, God. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. If you want to remain standing for the Word, we're going to do a little differently. We're going to go back to old school. Kind of stand for the Word. You know, sometimes change is good, but sometimes change isn't good. Sometimes you need to go back to the basics. So I'm going to go to Judges 6, chapter 6 and the 7th verse. Please bear with me. I've been losing my voice for about 2 or 3 weeks now. I'm not going to give you the title of my sermon right off the bat because I don't want you looking at me like, oh man, he's going to be stepping on some toes. But in Judges 6th chapter in the 7th verse, and it says, "And it came to pass when the children of Israel cried unto the Lord because of the Midianites." You say, well, that's just kind of a short verse. Stick with me. We'll go with that. Dear Heavenly Father, I thank you for who you are. I thank you for how great you are. I thank you for your presence already this morning, God. I thank you for the anointing. I thank you, God, for being in the house, God, right here and right now. And God, I ask that you speak through me. Don't hear me, God. I don't want them to hear me, God. I want them to hear you. And I ask that, God, you will move up and down the aisles, in and out of the pews, God. You will have the ears to hear, the eyes to see. God, the hearts will be touched this morning. And I give you glory and honor in Jesus' name. Amen. You may be seated. You know, I'm going to start out of the gates kind of hard right off the bat. You know, I've been looking at this society, I've been looking at our world, I've been looking at our church, and I've been looking at a lot of things, you know, and I was going in other ways, and God kept bringing me back to this, and kept bringing me back to this, and kept bringing me back to this. And finally it was like, okay, I get it, God, I get it. I get it. But you see, it's time we Christians faced up to the sad fact about ourselves. The Church of Jesus Christ is full of wimps. were full of wimps. When I use the term wimp, I am not being sarcastic. I simply don't know another word better to describe the spiritual cowardness sweeping through our churches. See, I'm not talking about everyday Christians, of course, but the house of God is filled with weaklings who are afraid of the devil. Afraid of his wrath, who never stand up to him, and who are constantly abused by his power of hell. We're constantly cowering, we're constantly backing down, we're constantly being fearful. I've only got this halfway full and I haven't started preaching yet. You see, the Bible warns that in the last days, Satan has come forth in great wrath because he knows his time is short. He's wanting to take as many people as he can down with him. So he's coming at us harder. Look at the way the world is today. Tell me you don't see that it's getting worse. It's getting bad. I mean, it's getting to the point where he is attacking anybody and everybody he can attack. And he's coming in full force. You see, he has brought his entire arsenal against God's people, trying to wear them down. He has sent legions of lying, demonic spirits to seduce and harass the church. He is trying to shut down the church. He's trying to take away the church's influence. He's trying to take away everything that the church used to represent. Even now, he is injecting into believers' minds all manners of lies, bringing guilt, condemnation, depression, and fear. Depression is huge. I hear depression all the time. I see depression all the time. You see, so few believers know how to stand up and fight. It's getting worse every generation. With all the talk going on in the church about spiritual warfare, Christians still have not learned how to stand up to the enemy. Still has not learned to plant the feet square down, shoulders back, and go full force with the devil. You see, we are pushovers for the devil. I don't believe every misfortune that befalls Christians comes from the devil. Don't get me wrong. Some people believe the devil's after, you know, around every bush and every single thing that ever happens wrong is automatically devil's fault. We wrongly blame him for a lot of our own carelessness, disobedience, and laziness. Let me tell you something. Your horrible nightmare that you had because you ate a whole bucket full of hot peppers and a liter of Pepsi, and you think, oh, the devil's harassing me because I had a dream there was a buffalo on my stomach jumping up and down laughing at me. That wasn't the devil tormenting you, it was your own doing. You can't blame the devil, or you can't blame God, when we have a $500,000 house, 6 brand new cars, 4 four-wheelers, and we're in debt. You may think the devil's harassed me all night long, but it's our own doing. It's easy to blame the devil for the foolishness that way. You see, we don't have to deal with it then. But see, there is a real devil present in our world today. You see, and he is busy, and he's at work. He's at full force. You see, he don't sleep. He's constantly causing torment. Constantly trying to destroy the church. Constantly trying to pull you down. How else can we explain what has happened to the multitudes of Christians? Many are nothing like their Savior. They backbite, they gossip, they complain, they're jealous, unkind, unmerciful. They live year after year in bitterness, hatred, covetousness. I mean, you look at the world today, there is a lot of hate. A lot of hate. I mean, every time you turn around, it's hate, hate, hate. I don't like the way this person does. So, you know, it's just hate all the time. I know people in churches who say that, you know, I've seen it as a pastor's kid and seeing it and being in the ministry and everything else. I've seen in churches where they swear they love their pastor, yet they listen to the vicious gossips about them. They allow the half-truth rattle on and do nothing to shut it up. Let me tell you something of Satan's strategy. If he cannot pull the Almighty out of his throne, he will tear God's image out of you. He wants to turn worshipers into murmurers. Just as he sought to get Job and Peter, Satan begs God to get out of you, to sift you as wheat. I want to show you. I want to let me take this person right here. Yeah, everything's going good for him right now or her right now. God, oh, they're just serving you. That's what he told Job. He says, just serving you for what he can get out of you. But you see, there are two things every believer must know when Satan comes in like a roaring lion. Number one, Satan cannot attack you at will. See, God has put a wall of fire around each of his children, and Satan cannot go beyond that wall without God's permission. Satan has no authority that God does not allow. But God does allow the wall to come down sometimes. He does this to produce unshakable faith in us, to train us in warfare, and to prove His power and glory on earth. How do we not learn if we don't have a little bit of trials? How do we not get stronger if we don't go through a little bit more? It's the same thing in every athlete when they work. Sometimes they're sore. Sometimes they're to the point the next day because they work so hard to be better, to be stronger. If they're wanting to run a race and they're wanting to run and you know in the Olympics or whatever, they are constantly working harder and harder. And sometimes it's hard and sometimes they're hurting. Sometimes they're so sore. But to be able to go to the next step, you've got to go through that process. The same thing in our faith. Our faith will never grow stronger if we never have trials and we never have to face anything. But you see, with every trial we face comes this promise. In 1 Corinthians 10:13, God is faithful, who will not suffer you to be tempted above that ye are able, but will with the temptation also make a way to escape that ye may be able to bear it. He will always leave a way out. It's the perfect phrase, that one of my favorites that Chris gives and uses. It's, if God brings you to it, thank you, He'll bring you through it. And that's exactly what's going to happen. He will bring you through it. Yes, it's going to be hard. Yes, there's times things are going to be tough. But He will always bring you through it. Number two, Satan also cannot read a Christian's mind. So many people think that. Some people are afraid to pray because they think the devil eavesdrops on them. Others think that the devil can read their thoughts. He cannot. That's not it. See, only God is everywhere present at the same time and is all-knowing. Not the devil. Yes, he's got a lot of legion, a lot of devils that go around his little minions, but he is not everywhere. For it says, Jeremiah 17:10, I, the Lord, search the heart. And Revelations 2:23, I am He which searches the reins and the heart. See, only the Lord can read our minds and our thoughts. That's another reason why it's kind of funny that sometimes we think we're hiding things. It's kind of like nobody will ever know. Well, maybe not the people in the church, maybe not the friends, maybe not the people around. But God knows everything. He knows your very thoughts. So that's why He says, some people say, well, then why do I even cry to Him? Why do I even talk to Him if He already knows? Why should I ask Him? He already knows. Because He wants you to tell Him. He's not going to force nothing. He wants you to ask, hey, I need you. But you know, the sad thing is that Satan doesn't need to read our minds. Because he can read our actions. He watches our footsteps, notices where we go, what we do, what we say. He don't need to read the minds of a lot because he sits there and he watches what we do. He knows already what we're getting ready to do. He knows when we slip away to do something we shouldn't. He sees our weakness and he injects lies to suit his needs. See, he hears our conversations about how frail and weak we are and he tries to frighten us over our weakness. That's why we always talk about negative talk. Negative talk, he feeds on that. But if we have positive talk, we're constantly saying, I'm never going to make it through this. I can't make it through this. I'm not going to make it through this. I'm not going to make it through this. Devil sees that weakness, and he's going to feed on that. And he's going to keep telling you, you're right. You can't make it. You're not going to make it through here. But when we come and we believe in God's promises, and we believe that God's going to bring us through, and we start saying, I will come through this. God is going to bring me through this. Then the devil can't feed on that. But see, he feeds because he hears and he knows. You see, Scripture commands us to stand up, be strong, and do battle against the flesh and the devil. God commands us to stand firm, stand strong, keep fighting. See, in 1 Corinthians 16:13 says, be on the alert, stand firm in the faith, act like men and be strong. Ephesians 6:10 says, brethren, be strong in the Lord and in the power of His might. You're not on your own. It says right there, be strong in the Lord. He's going to give you the strength to fight. He's going to be there. You're not using your strength. You can't make it. But you're using His strength. 2 Timothy 2:1 says, be strong in the grace that in Christ Jesus. You see, in 1 John 2:14, young men, ye are strong, and in the word of God abideth in you, and you have overcome the wicked one. You see, in the last verse, the Apostle John was not talking about 80-year-old men. He was talking about young men. He was addressing young warriors who were full of God's word. See, John was telling them, because you took a stand, because you didn't back down, because you stood your ground and believed His word to you, you have won the battle over the devil. Because you stand strong. God's word is not a wimp Bible. You see? And our message is not a wimp gospel. God is looking for people who are warriors rather than wimps. Ready to stand strong and believe His word. We are prophesied to win the battle, but only if we stand up and we fight. Scripture says we are more than conquerors. Totally victorious over all the power of the enemy. He's already told us we're more than conquerors, so why do we fear? Why do we back down? Why do we allow the devil to take our people, to take our children, to abuse our family, to try to take our joy away? Because he says right there, we are more than conquerors. See, the Old Testament warriors were mighty in battle against satanic forces. See, in Hebrews 11:33-34 says, they subdued kingdoms, wrought righteousness, obtained promises, stopped the mouth of the lion, quenched the violence of fire, escaped the edge of the sword, out of the weakness were made strong. But something is terribly wrong today. It's sad to say, but it is. Too many Christians are weak-kneed, powerless, easily victimized, manipulated, humiliated by Satan. We allow him to beat us up. We allow him to be a bully. We allow him to knock us around, and we just keep doing it. But honestly, I believe it's time we become victorious warriors. As a church, we need to be victorious, not wimps. You see, the story of Gideon in Judges 6:7 tells us how God turned a group of wimps into warriors. You see, I see this story 4 steps to becoming a fearless warrior against Satan. Step number 1, you must get sick and tired of being sick and tired. It's got to be to the point I'm backed up in the corner and I'm not taking no more. I'm sick of being this way. I'm sick of him taking my joy. I'm sick of him taking my family. I'm sick of him taking my children. I'm sick of the sickness in my church. You have to become fed up with being held down by the devil, living low, depressed, joyless, empty, and harassed life. It has to get to a point where you're at a point where it says, I am not taking no more. I'm done. You see, the book of Judges tells us in 6 and the verse 1 and 2, it says, and the children of Israel did evil in the sight of the Lord, and the Lord delivered them into the hand of Midian 7 years. And the hand of Midian prevailed against Israel. See, every year at harvest time, the Midianites moved over Israel's land with thousands of camels and sheep and cattle. See, these animals ate everything in sight, leaving Israel poor. You know, all their crops, all their stuff that they would farm and all that, and then they'd just come through when it's done and take it all. See, in verse 6, so Israel was brought very low because of the Midianites. They were low. They were at the bottom. See, indeed, the Israelites were at their lowest point ever. They were driven in living into dark caves and damp dens. They were starving. They were scared. They were helpless. They were constantly fearing. Then something finally happened, and it started with Gideon. And it spread throughout the whole camp. Israel got sick and tired of hiding in the caves. Could you imagine that? They can't even live in their own homes. They can't even stay in their own beds. They have to live in caves because they're so scared. See, Gideon had grown weary after 7 long years. He was tired of the Midianites prevailing over Israel. See, I picture him on the mountainside looking over at all the tribes. He's watched as the warriors and the horsebacks, and they come trampling through, plundering Israel's villages, trying to kill everything and everyone. I could see him saying to himself, how long should we put up with this? How long do we got to deal with this? They go through our land with no opposition, and all we do is coward and run and full of fear. But here we are. We're told we have a God who moved for our fathers. But look at us now. We're stripped helpless. We live in constant fear. Sadly, this is the picture of how most Christians live today, in fear. The enemy has come and robbed them of all their peace and effectiveness. He's plundered their lives and families at will, and they give no opposition. Instead, they hide in some dark cave of depression and bitterness. And they simply stand by as Satan brings more calamity upon their homes. They have been brought low, low in faith, low in strength, low in attitude. That is just where Israel was. Yet something rose up within Gideon, and he said just what God wanted to hear. This has gone far enough. We serve a mighty, victorious God. Why do we go on day after day taking abuse? Day after day. For 7 years we have hidden in these caves and let the Midianites roam freely over us, and no fight, no resistance, no standing up. I ask you, how low are you this morning? How far down has the devil brought you? Is it to the point of depression? Is it a point of bitterness? Is it a point of fear? When are you going to wake up and say, enough is enough, church? When are we going to wake up and say, the devil is not going to rob my family anymore? He's not going to take from me anymore. He's not going to rob my joy. He's not going to take my peace away. God will not do anything until we're thoroughly disgusted, until we're at that point, until we are sick and tired of being sick and tired. He's going to let us get to that point. He's going to look and he's like, I ain't going to force nothing on you. If you're content with this, then go ahead and keep going. I mean, you let me know when you're sick and tired of it, and you call me and we'll take care of it. And verse 6 says, the people then cried unto the Lord, and that's just what God wanted them to do. Cry unto me. You may be thinking, I can't stand the fight of the devil. I can't stand a fight with him. He's too big. He's too strong. You say, I'm praying. I'm paying for my sins. I've done too much. I'm wrong. I'm not good enough. I've sinned. I've failed God. All these things are happening because the devil knows he's got me. If that is true, then all you got to do is what Gideon did. Just cry out to God. Cry out to God. We serve the same God that Israel did. And if He heard the Israel's cry, He will hear you in the depths of your failure. It doesn't matter how far you fall. You see, so many people think that you've fallen too far for God to forgive. It doesn't matter. God forgives. It don't matter if you were once a murderer one time. It didn't matter once if you were a thief, if you were a drug addict. It didn't matter what your past is. God is only concerned about your future. He's concerned about right now. What is going on right now? The moment you cry out to God, something happens in the heavens, you see? You may not be able to see it, but God has already begun to work on your behalf. He's already starting to move behind the scenes. You don't know, you might not see it, but once you cry out to God, He's already working. He's already moving. He's already putting the pieces together for that victory. Step two, deal with your fears and unbelief. See, Israel's have fallen into adultery. You know, speaking of that, I loved what Sister Poole said this morning. I've never heard quite that way. And she was talking about so many people and they call it, and, you know, oh, they don't have other gods. But, you know, some people call it by different names. Excuses. And when she said that, it was just like, yes, exactly. It's excuses. We don't always call it another god like they do or they say in them when it was like, you know, oh, well, we serve Baal, we serve this. Your TV. It's your phone. It's your computer. It's whatever it is that is hindering you from your relationship with God. It's whatever you put before God, that's it. Excuses. But here we see, we serve a God of Israel did, you know. And here we see that the two things is the unbelief. You see, but their root sins was still unbelief, resulting in all kinds of fear. And God sent them a prophet to expose their root sin. You know, they're, oh God, help us. Well, obviously I got to send somebody to you. When they cried unto the Lord because of the Midianites, the Lord sent the prophet unto children of Israel, which said unto them, this saith the Lord God of Israel, I delivered you out of the hand of the Egyptians, out of the hand of that oppressed you, and drove them out from before you, and gave you their land. And I said unto you, I am the Lord your God, fear not the gods of the Amorites, in whose land ye dwell, but ye have not obeyed my voice. God was saying, I command you, fear not, but you disobeyed and feared. Now I cannot finish my work until you have dealt with your fears. The prophet told them, look at you, a bunch of wimps holding out or hiding out, afraid to stand up and fight. You've already given up. But you have a history of a God that delivers. Why are you fearing? Look at the history of our God. Look at your life and all that He's brought you through, and we still fear that we are not going to make it. He gave your fathers great victories when they trusted Him, and He was promised to deliver you, yet you don't believe Him. How many times do we go for God, and we go to Him, and we pray, but yet really deep down we're not sure that He's going to do it or He can do it? He brought you out of slavery and defeated all your past enemies. Why do you now act like you're helpless cowards? He has brought you through time and time again. There is no need for any of us to ever doubt Him. No matter what comes our way, we should never have to have fear. See, Moses had instructed Israel in Deuteronomy 20:14, be not afraid of them, let not your hearts faint, fear not, and do not tremble, neither be ye terrified. He was saying, God is with us, and because He is present, you have no reason to be terrified. You are never to be afraid of the enemy. He will not let you fall. Many Christians, however, are terrified of the devil is going to destroy them. They're fearing him. They're afraid they're going to make mistakes, go back on their sin, and the devil will have his way. But you see, that's a lie from the pits of hell. See, the Bible says you don't have to be terrified as you walk through life. When you hold on to fear, it becomes contagious. See, everybody around you catches it. As you see, evidence of that, Gideon sent home every warrior who was fearful. Look at the scriptures. That's what he did. In verses it says, what man is there that is fearful and faint-hearted? Let him go and return unto his house, lest his brethren's heart faint as well as his heart. God says, I don't need any unbelief. I don't need anybody that's scared and fearful that doesn't believe I'm going to bring you through. So if you don't believe I'm going to bring you through, you go on home. He was saying, just go home, otherwise you'll destroy the victory for those who rise up to do the battle. I need men and women that are going to stand up and fight, that isn't going to be fearful, that's going to believe I'm going to bring them through. See, in Judges 7:3, 22,000 wimps went home. Boy, that was kind of harsh. 22,000 went home, all quaking in their sandals, afraid of the forces of hell. But God has said to Gideon, I must have men of faith, men of courage, men and women that are going to stand. Tell these to go home and pray until they have developed a backbone. God is speaking the same word to His church today. He is asking, why do you fear? Why are you letting all the things of this life and this world cause you so much fear? Why do you sin by not trusting me to bring victory to your life? I have promised to defeat every demonic power that comes against you. I promise to bring you through. I promise to take care of every situation. Yet some Christians will never change. They can't get along without their pet murmuring and complaining. They are hooked on misery. They sound like the worldly crowd. All their talk is a misery, 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 misery. It's all about divorce, cheating, family problems, job problems, headaches, sicknesses, who's in what hospital, whose kids are in jail, which husband is a drunken bum, which secretary ran off with which boss. Without their misery, they have nothing to talk about. Yet those who seek the Lord are built upon His faith, and faith is by hearing His word to them. So then faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. That is Scripture, Romans 10:17. And hear God's word to all who call on His name. In Isaiah 40:10-12, it says, fear thou not, for I am with thee. Be not dismayed, for I am thy God. I will strengthen thee. I will help thee. I will uphold thee with the right hand of my righteousness. They that strive with thee shall perish. They that war against thee shall be as nothing and as a thing of naught. Scripture right there tells you, I will uphold you. I will give you strength. I will give you every single thing you need. Don't fear. I'm going to bring you through. Pastor, you don't understand what I'm going through. It doesn't matter. God will bring you through. God will bring you through. Blessed be the Lord, the God of Israel, to grant us that we, being delivered from the hand of our enemies, might serve Him without fear, in holiness and righteousness for all of His days. Bear with me, I'm getting there. I'm almost done. Without fear and holiness and righteousness before. See, God says you can live in victory and righteousness without fear. All of the days of your life, not just on Sunday, not just on Tuesday or just certain parts of the day, every day of your life, God says you can live in victory. Step 3. Pull down your besetting sin. In 6:25, he says, now the same night the Lord said to him, pull down the altar of Baal, which belongs to your father. You see, God told Gideon, I'm not going to deliver you. I'm not going to deliver Israel until you get rid of the idol that stands between us. I can't deliver you until you get rid of that God that is in between us. I can't deliver you until you get rid of that is separating us. In your house. In your life. He says, I can't get rid of it. Lay it aside. Cut it down. So in the middle of the night, Gideon took 10 men of his servants, and he did as the Lord said unto him. He took an ox and used ropes to pull down the Baal. See, God is giving His church today the same message He gave Gideon. I want to help you, but I can't when you don't trust me. You're full of fear, and before I can bring deliverance, you're going to have to pull down the stronghold that's besetting your sin. If it's fear, then we need to get rid of it. Hebrews 12:1, it says, lay aside every weight and the sin which does so easily beset you. We are to pull down all strongholds of fear and sin. Anything that is hindering our walk with God. Anything that is causing us not to have the relationship that He wants. Gideon pulled down demonic strongholds using a strong ox. But let me tell you something, church. We have been given weapons far more powerful than this. Far more powerful. Where He says in 2 Corinthians 10, 4-5, for the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but mighty through God to pulling down the strongholds, casting down, bringing into captivity. He tells us right there, mighty through God. There is only one way to bring down the besetting sin. In Jude 20:24, it says, building up yourself on your most holy faith. Praying in the Holy Ghost is able to keep you from falling and to present you faultless before the presence of His glory is an exceeding joy. Your faith and prayer. See, all victory comes by praying in faith. God provides the victory for you as you pray, but you have to keep going back to Him again and again, praying in the Holy Ghost against the besetting sin. It doesn't go to the point where I only sit praying on Sunday. It isn't where I prayed once, God, so that should be good enough. No, you need to pray constantly. If you got a need and it ain't been met, you prayed on Monday and Tuesday's still not met, you keep praying, you keep praying, you keep praying, and you keep praying. Say, where's that scripture? I'll give it to you right here. Romans 12:12. It talks about, it says, be constant prayer. Be in constant prayer. Colossians 4:2, it says, continue steadfastly in prayer. 1 Thessalonians 5:17 says, pray without ceasing. The scripture is full of it. It says, pray, 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 pray. Prayer is so important. Prayer changes things. Have you ever heard a family that prays together stays together? A church that prays together stays together. Number four, learn to stand up to Satan on your own. You have to learn to fight your own battles. You can't depend on someone else to do your deliverance. I mean, don't get me wrong, we look to God to give us the strength and everything like that. But so many times we look to our brothers or our sister or our mother or our father to do the praying for us, to stand for us. Perhaps you have a prayer warrior friend you can call on and say, I've got a battle before me. Well, you pray for me. I know you're a prayer warrior. That's fine. There's nothing wrong with saying, God, hey, pray for me. But you've got to stand and fight. You can't let somebody else do the fighting for you. It is not God's complete will for you. God wants you to become a warrior. If the worshipers want to come on up, or the prayer team, you see, He wants you to stand against the devil. He wants you to stand up. Jesus has promised us, I am with you always. I'm with you always. I'm not just with this person. I'm not just with that person. I'm with you always. He kept paring down Gideon's men until they were 300 were left. 300 was all that left out of 22,000 men. But God said, that's all I needed. 300 men of God. 300 fearless, courageous men of God. They came down upon their enemies from the hill, screaming, yelling, smashing pitchers, and blowing trumpets. And all the hosts of their enemies ran and cried and fled. 300. They were outnumbered big time. God says, I don't need a big army. I can take this amount that believes in me instead of this amount that doesn't. God will show you how to get out of your problem. And that is what a warrior does. They reject defeat. They cast out the fear. As they begin praying and finishing up here, you see, they tear down their besetting sin through prayer. And finally, they stand on God's Word, preparing their heart before the Lord to receive victory. You see, the Word of God is a sword. It's represented as a sword. You take the Word of God, you take that sword, and you start cutting down the enemy. You start cutting down the lies. He gave that to you as a weapon. Gideon didn't have any might. He was a wimp. Gideon's might was bound up in God's Word to him. When he said, "Surely I will be with you. Surely I will be with you." The same word, "I am with you." Your strength. And you receive that strength by believing His Word is true. By acting on it. See, it's time for the church to stand up. It's time for the church to quit backing down, letting the devil beat them, push them around, knock them down. The Scriptures clearly say we are more than conquerors. We have the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords on our side. We don't need to fear. He said, "I'll take care of it." He says, "You just stand up, you fight, and I'm right here beside you." We'll start slicing down that enemy. We'll start cutting away at that enemy. This morning, I want to leave the altars open. I don't know what you're going through. I don't know what fear it is or what it is. But God says He's looking for men and women. He needs men and women that's going to stand up and not back down from the enemy. That's going to stand on His Word believing, "I am with you to the very end. I will bring you through. Do not fear. Do not fear. Do not fear. Do not fear." As they begin to sing, I'm going to leave the altars open. Come to God and help Him. Say, "God, give me your strength. Help me not to be a wimp. Help me to stand strong. Help me to be able to deliver your word, to be able to stand strong on your word. That when people see me, they don't see me, they see you. The devil's not going to be able to see my actions and say, 'Oh, this is a target.' I want him to look at me and say, 'Oh, I'm avoiding this one. I'm avoiding this one.'" The altars are open.
In the name of the Lord, though Satan rages, we cannot be defeated. That all our enemies will crumble at our feet. Whatsoever we bind on earth shall be bound in heaven. At the name of Jesus, Satan has to flee. We've got the power in the name of Jesus. We've got the power. be defeated. We've got the power in the name of the Lord. We've got the power in the name of Jesus. We've got the power in the name of the Lord. Though Satan rages, we cannot be defeated. We've got the power in the name of the Lord.
I took back what he stole from me. Oh, I went to the enemy's camp, and I took back what he stole from me. He's under my feet. Satan is under my feet. Oh, I went to the enemy's camp, and I took back what he stole from me. Oh, I took back what he stole from me. Yes, I took back what he stole from me. Oh, I went to the enemy's camp, and I took back what he stole from me. He's under my feet. Yes, he's under my feet. He's under my feet. Satan is under my feet.
Hope you guys got blessed. I hope that you leave with something that God just touched your heart, and that you stand and he just gives you that fire to just want to take off. Don't forget services tonight. Come expecting. Amen. Come expecting. God says we are to come expecting him to do great things. Amen. If great things don't happen in service, it's not because of God. Because God had his will, and God had what he wanted, but he's not going to force it. Every service would be mind-blowing. So come expecting God's going to do some great things tonight. Be safe. Might be still slick out there. God bless. You guys have a good night or good evening.